A very good morning to all. Looking at important headlines from the Hindu newspaper for 28 September, on the front page you have, "It is imperative for the world to unite against terrorism, Modi." So this is Prime Minister Narendra Modi, who addressed the 74th session of the UN General Assembly, and he spoke about how the world needs to unite to combat terrorism. Also, he spoke about how his government's developmental and environmental record as such, has benefited the population. So he spoke about Clean India mission as an inspiration to the world. Then next is, Supreme Court orders 25 lakh rupees each in interim relief to flat owners. So in Kerala, the flats which have to be demolished, we had seen this is the Maradu buildings, which have been set up along the coast, violating the CRZ norms, coastal regulatory zone norms. So Supreme Court has ordered for their demolition. The Kerala state municipality has also got their electricity connections disconnected, but the homeowners, they stay put and they are not ready to vacate the houses. Now Supreme Court has ordered 25 lakh each in interim relief to the flat owners. And Kerala will demolish flats and remove debris by February 9, 2020. This is what the Kerala Chief Secretary's affidavit in Supreme Court has also stated, that demolition would take place in 90 days, removal of debris in 30 days, and all activities will be completed by February 9, 2020. Then below you have, UP doctor absolved of key charges. So this is the incident in Uttar Pradesh which took place at BRD hospital. Here, babies, infants died due to lack of oxygen supply. So in this case, Dr. Kafil Khan, who was appointed to the pediatric ward at the hospital then, several infants died there over a period of 48 hours. So he was arrested. Now a government appointed internal inquiry has absolved the doctor of key charges. So it was not he who was responsible for the tragedy. It was actually lack of oxygen supply which resulted in infants dying, and this lack of oxygen supply was due to the oxygen supply being stopped because of non-payment of dues. So the real culprits have not yet been arrested and he has been given a clean check. On page 5 you have, "Treat us for silicosis, not TB, minors in MP." So minors in Madhya Pradesh are suffering from silicosis and they have decided to organize themselves to press for adequate compensation and appeal to the government for right treatment instead of being treated for tuberculosis. So there are around 10,000 minors from 40 villages in this district, Ganj Bazoda district of Madhya Pradesh. So they have come together and they're drawing inspiration from Jodhpur's Raju Devi, who after her husband's death due to silicosis organized around 25,000 minors and secured their rights. So this is a very important issue from social rights perspective too, plus also there are occupational hazards. So minors, they suffer from diseases like silicosis because of the occupation. Silicon sand as such enters into their respiratory system. So this is there. On page 8 you have, "No right to block road for religious purposes, High Court." So this is Karnataka High Court who has given this ruling that denial of permission to put up temporary structures on roads and footpaths for religious purposes or functions will not infringe upon right to freedom of free profession, practice and propagation of religion under Article 25 of the Constitution. So if denial of permission happens, it's not infringement of right, that your right is violated. So this is what the Karnataka High Court ruled. It was a case of Bengaluru city where a complaint had come that public road was closed for a couple of days for the festival of Panduranga temple in Thyagarajanagar. So on this, the Karnataka High Court has ruled that inspection should take place of where the temporary structure has to be built. Permission should be taken from viewpoint should be taken from traffic police, and only then permission can be granted if it would not cause any traffic obstruction. This is what it says. So a report from traffic police has to be taken on impact of free flow of traffic if permission is granted to the temporary structure. So grant of right is not grant of permission for temporary structures is not a right. It may be denied too, is what the Karnataka High Court is saying. It depends on how it would affect the traffic. And above you have Tamil Nadu police blow lid of a huge scam in NEET. So the crime branch CID of Tamil Nadu police has blown the lid of this huge scam in which plus two students, 12 standard students who appeared for NEET, National Eligibility Cum Entrance Test, which is for medical entrance, for undergraduate and postgraduate medical entrance. So they were engaged, they had engaged proxy candidates to simultaneously write the exam for them with the same credentials in other centers. And they managed to get admission to medical colleges. So this you can see. So the photos were not checked. They said if photos had been checked properly, this scam could have been detected earlier. And it seems those who appeared for these students were either teachers or doctors with competency to score well in NEET. Such a scam is going on. It is feared this is a nationwide scam. On page 9, you have Chandrayaan's Vikram had hard landing, says US Space Agency. So this is a screen grab of Chandrayaan 2 lander Vikram's targeted landing site between two craters on the lunar south pole, which has been captured by LRO, Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter of NASA. So it has released a set of hazy images of the southern site where the lander probably crashed. Then below you have India, Nepal, Bhutan to count tigers in high altitudes. So, with studies earlier this year reporting the presence of tigers in high altitude regions in India, experts from India, Nepal and Bhutan under the aegis of their governments will now in 2020 begin a detailed assessment of how entrenched tigers are in this region. So, it is said that, you know, the Himalayan habitat of these tigers, it is potentially 52,671 square kilometer of tiger habitat. So out of this, 38,915 square kilometer is in India. So it is said India is home to the most number of tigers in the world, but then most of them are cursed in central India and the western Ghats. But this latest tiger survey made public showed that there are 2,967 tigers all over India. And camera traps were used to detect the presence of tigers in higher altitudes and found only three, two in Sikkim and one in Uttarakhand. So there may be more tigers. So survey would be undertaken jointly next year. So there is this Global Tiger Forum as such, which is an intergovernmental body that coordinates activities on tiger conservation. On the editorial page, the first editorial is not their business. So this is regarding yesterday's front page news, Organization of Islamic Cooperation. Its Kashmir contact group called on India to rescind its action of revoking Article 370 and, you know, other directions which it gave or, you know, ordered India to follow those lines. But then the editorial rightly points out that OIC achieved little other than pleasing Pakistan through its Kashmir pronouncements. And it is not their business to point out what India should be doing. So it says the OIC's record of conflict resolution when it comes to issues between OIC member states is poor. So it cannot resolve conflicts within its own members. And here it is asking India as such to take action. It wants Article 370 to be revoked. The military should be, you know, removed from Kashmir and all such demands are there. Then this is running for president. So this is the second Premadas, which is said to be against a second Rajapaksa in race for Sri Lanka's presidency. So this is Sajit Premadas, that is Sri Lanka's UNP candidate, who is the strongest candidate to take on former Defence Secretary Gotabaya Rajapaksa in presidential elections, which will be held in Sri Lanka in November. So this is regarding that. And here you have the lead article, the top court and a grave of freedom. So this is regarding a number of judgments by the highest court, that is Supreme Court, which is replete with cases where the bogey of security has trumped basic rights. So there are many such cases, like, you know, the rights in Kashmir. So in the name of security, you know, because it is a security matter, it has not looked into the rights issues. So this is called a faulty trade-off in this article. And this is, as Z comes a calling, a footprint without traction. So this says that Nepal will gain little from China's outreach unless there is a recalibration in its long-term vision of development. So this is regarding China-Nepal relations, and they have consequences for India. So this is very important. Then on Sundays, you have Ground Zero coverage. And today this is regarding discontent in Hong Kong. It says 6 months since the protest in Hong Kong began, young Hong Kongers are in no mood to negotiate and Beijing refuses to budge. China refuses to budge. So this article talks of hopes and concerns of a deeply divided city in a country with two seemingly irreconcilable systems. So Hong Kong wants democracy and China is a communist country. On page 12, you have Supreme Court unhappy with Ayodhya hearing pace. So this is what the Chief Justice of India, Ranjan Gogoi, says, that things are not going as per our schedule. He says, we'll go on arguing and we'll go on hearing till my last working day. Today is the 32nd day of arguments. What is this? So this is regarding how the Chief Justice of India is actually going to retire soon. So, and there will be a court holidays for Dasera. So he's not happy with the pace at which the hearing is taking place. So, in the context that he wants the judgment to come before he retires. This is regarding that. But there is no such provision in any judicial, you know, diktat as such. No? On international page, you have continuation of the same news of President Trump's impeachment inquiry being initiated. And here you have UK flagged tanker Stena Impero sets sail after release by Iran. So Iran had seized this British flagged oil tanker, which it was held by Iran off Bandar Abbas, the port of Iran, for more than 2 months now. And now it has been set sail and it reached international waters. So it was in July that it was seized after hitting a fishing boat. Then here you have Facebook begins hiding likes in Australia. So Facebook said that it began hiding the number of likes for posts in Australia, and it is a trial designed to ease social pressures that could be rolled out worldwide. So account holders, you know, across the country were also blocked from viewing the number of reactions and video views of other people's posts. But they were still able to see how people responded to their own posts. So he says, we don't want Facebook to feel like a competition. This is a test to see how people engage with this new format. On business page, you have CapEx on track to meet target, says finance minister. So capital expenditure of the government, it is said by her, is on track and will meet the budgeted target by the end of the financial year. And ministries are told to provide plan for 4 quarters and release all dues to services and goods suppliers. So this is a meeting with secretaries and financial advisors of key ministries, which finance minister had. And this is finance commission to arrive at devolution limit independently. So finance ministry has been asking 15th finance commission for a lower limit for tax devolution to states. But the chairman's office said that the center's plea was just one among 30 different requests, including those from states. And the commission would decide its devolution formula independently after balancing all the requests. So 14th Finance Commission had recommended 42% of center's tax revenues to be transferred to states, which was a significant increase from recommendation of previous finance commissions. So now the center wants this to reduce. And you should know about the finance commission, it is appointed for giving recommendations for a period of 5 years. So for 5 years from 1st April 2020, the 15th Finance Commission's recommendations would be applicable. So it is looking into, it is framing up those provisions now. The 15th Finance Commission is chaired by Mr. N.K. Singh. Then this is Bharat 22 ETF, fourth tranche on October 4th. So this is the fourth tranche of Bharat 22 ETF. So this is going to be announced now. So it is said it will help government, it will help garner up to 8,000 crore from investors. You should know about ETF. So what is an ETF? It's an exchange traded fund. So it can be traded on the stock exchange. So stocks are actually, you know, traded as such on stock exchanges, but this is a fund and a mutual fund. What is a mutual fund is a number of stocks brought together, and then you know, based on how these stocks are doing, the mutual fund house will pay, it is called asset management company, will pay to the customers who have invested in their mutual fund. So rather than individual deciding which stock to invest in and which not, he invests in a mutual fund, and mutual fund invests that money in various stocks, and then it pays back to the people who have invested, along with a cut as such for its services. But now there is something called exchange traded fund, which is like both stocks and mutual funds. So it is actually a diversified fund. So it has number of stocks, number of companies coming together, and it is in ETF itself in which investment takes place, and it's traded like stock. So you buy a share of this ETF rather than of individual companies. So an exchange traded fund called Bharat 22 was announced, which comprises of various, you can see, stocks of various companies like L&T, ITC, SBI, Axis Bank, etc. These are some which have the highest weightage in the Bharat 22. So there are these 22 companies. It consists of central public sector enterprises, public sector banks, and strategic holdings of SUPI as such too. So this is there. So center has this present news is that it has announced a fourth tranche of ETFs. So they are popular equity investment tool globally, because risks are spread over a basket of stocks and fund management expenses ratios are also very low compared to mutual funds. So you can see it is 0.0095% compared to mutual funds fund expense ratio, fund management expense ratio of 2.5%. And this is further detail regarding Bharat 22 ETF. You can see it has number of companies under it, like some from energy sector, some from basic materials, some banks as such, fast moving consumer goods companies like ITC, you know, industrials like L&T, utilities, etc. So here it's detailed out how ETFs are akin to mutual funds, but with a defined asset basket, like shares of an index. It cannot change. The asset basket is fixed. The mutual fund company may invest in some company, remove, and you know, it can change. But here the asset basket is fixed. And they are more liquid than mutual funds, as they can be traded on stock exchanges. So they can easily be traded. And the value of units of ETF depends on the value of assets held by the fund. So this is there regarding Bharat 22 ETF. And this is center looking to ease foreign investment limits in government bonds. So India is looking to ease foreign investment limits in government bonds because it is seeking to get its securities included in global bond indices in the next 2 years. So government officials have spoken about this, that a special window for foreign passive investors that focus on index investing will be looked into. So even as it seeks to counter the risk posed by hot money flows from more actively managed funds. So more actively managed funds easily leave the country too. It's called hot money. So that is there. And this is crude oil imports from US jumped 72%. Iraq is top supplier. So India's crude oil imports from Iraq have jumped over, from USA have jumped over 72% in the first 5 months of the current financial year. And top supplier for India is Iraq. West Asian countries sales to India rose 12%. Nigeria ranks third. India has stopped importing from Iran following the reimposition of economic sanctions in May 2019. So till November we did, but after that we have not. From November till May we actually had. No, oil been imported because we were given exemption by US from sanctions, but from May 2019 we have completely stopped Iranian oil import. Saudi Arabia has traditionally been India's top source, but it was for the first time dethroned by Iraq. So now Saudi Arabia is second, Nigeria is third. US is making inroads, its import from US has jumped 72%. So these are the important headlines. The last page has sports news. So that is it. For detailed coverage of current affairs, you can visit our website aasha.com. PDFs uploaded for current affairs. You can download them. Thank you.